Well, good morning, everyone. You know, Jeff asked me last week, he gave me a couple of dates, and he's like, hey, Tommy, when do you want to preach? And I'm like, hey, how about the 17th? That sounds great. And that was before I knew what this weekend would entail, and now I wish I would have picked a different week. And but I'm happy to be here. I just want to say first that I'm thankful for you, Jeff, and for all that you've done to pour into me as a pastor. I'm a better pastor because of you. I'm a better father. I'm a better husband. I'm a better friend because of everything that I've seen in you and everything that you've taught me and poured into me. So thank you. Thank you. And maybe you're like me and you feel grieved this morning. Listen, I'm not the one that's going to be able to comfort you, to bring you comfort, not with my words. But what I can bring you this morning is that which always brings comfort to me and my life, which is the Word of God. So let's dive right into the message, shall we? We're going to be in Colossians chapter 3. We're going to be in verses 1 through 4. And while you're turning there, I just want to ask you a question. Have you ever felt like your life has been centered around something? Maybe it's your children. Maybe it's a sport. Maybe it's your children's sports. Maybe it's work. Maybe it's school. Maybe it's a mixture of the two happening at the same time. Maybe it's a situation, a circumstance, a tragedy. But you feel like your life revolves around that one thing. It is centered upon that one thing. It takes up all of your mind and all of your thinking. Your life is centered around that. You know, that happened to us just a couple of months ago. At the end of December, right before Christmas, we found out that our son was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. And our lives began to be centered around this, centered around this diagnosis, centered around diabetes. We were obsessed with the number. Where was his blood sugar at? Because if we didn't have a handle on this, it could be fatal. And so we were centered around this number, how high, how low. We were checking it every couple of hours, making sure that it was in a good place. And when it wasn't, we gave insulin shots, and we waited, and we checked some more. We stayed up all night making sure that he was okay in the hospital. Our lives centered around our son and this disease. And when we finally realized what was happening, that our lives was centering around this disease, around this number, we realized that we had to do something about that. And we were tired, and we were exhausted, and we were mentally and physically drained. Pastor Britt knows this firsthand because he came in to visit us at the hospital, and it was the middle of the day, and I was absolutely passed out in the chair, snoring, mouth open, drool maybe coming out of my mouth. He says that there was. I don't remember that so clearly, but it was a very compromising situation. I had just eaten lunch. We were really tired. I closed my eyes for a second. I was sweating. It was really weird. And Pastor Britt got to see all of that. He got to see us being just physically and mentally exhausted. But you know, when things get the hardest, when things get the most difficult, something that my wrestling background as a wrestler, I always had to know going into the hard matches, the difficult moments was that you always, in the hardest moments, you always go back to the fundamentals. You always go back to the fundamentals. And it is the same way in our faith. When we face our hardest moments, when we can't think about anything else, when we're struggling, we need to come back to the fundamentals of our faith. And the title of the message is The Christ-Centered Life. And it's really the fundamentals of the Christ-centered life. And that's exactly what we're going to see Paul writing about here in the passage today in chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. So I'm going to read that for us right now, verses 1 and 2. If then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on the things that are above, not on the things that are on earth. The first thing that we see right here in the passage, and you could probably even see it is that the first thing that we need to do, the first fundamental, is a person who seeks Jesus first. That's a person who has a Christ-centered life, the fundamental of seeks Jesus first. That seems pretty fundamental, right? Going back to the basics of our faith, the fundamental, seeks Jesus first. And you see, up to this point in Colossians, Paul has been writing about the things that Christians have been freed from. And in chapter 3, now he is writing about the things we have been freed for. In chapters 1 and 2, he wrote about the things that we have been freed from. And now he is writing about the things we have been freed for. Or another way to say it is the first two chapters are rich in theological truth about who Jesus Christ is, about what he has done for us, about who we are in him. And this, chapter 3, is kind of the turn. This is kind of the moment that, and the start of extremely practical ways to live that truth that he so elegantly and amazingly rolled out for us in chapters 1 and 2, how we can live that out. Now, there's more coming in chapter 3. We're going to only be in the first 4 verses. But as the weeks go on, we're going to be learning all of the practical ways to have a Christ-centered life. Chapter 3 goes on to talk about the things that we need to put off and the things that we need to put on, and instruction on marriage, instruction on parenting. Lots of that's to come, and I'm really excited to get into that as a church together. But before we really jump into the passage, I want to give you just two quick words. Two quick words that are going to be very helpful and important when you're studying and understanding Scripture. The first word is indicative. The first word is indicative. And maybe you're a college, like, English major, and you already know that word. I had to look it up, exactly what it meant. And indicative is a statement of who you are. It's a statement of who you are. Indicatives are statements of who you are. And Paul has been taking the time in Colossians 1 and 2 to tell us exactly who we are in Jesus Christ. This is who you are because of Christ. He's been taking the time to do that. The second word is imperative. Imperative. And what this is a command, a directive. You better do this. You've got to get this. You have to have this. It is imperative that you go and do this. And we're going to see both of these things happen in the scripture that we're about to read. So it says, if then you have been raised with Christ. If then you have been raised with Christ. Now, the word if there could be translated in two different ways. It could simply mean if, which is conditional. It's conditional, if. But I think the better translation here is since. Since then, you have been raised with Christ. And that's based on the audience that Paul is writing to. And he is making the assumption that they are all Christians who are reading this in the church. Since then. But listen, I don't want to make any assumptions here in church this morning. And the beautiful thing about our church is that every single week we have new people walking through the doors of our church and sitting in our seats and hearing from God's word. And I don't want to assume that everyone here understands the gospel, has received the gospel. And so I want to ask you just a question. And that question is what we see right here in the passage. Look down at it with me. If then you have been raised with Christ, here's the question. Have you been raised with Christ? Have you been raised with Christ? Now, maybe you've never heard that before. Maybe this is your first time coming into a church and you're like, have I been raised with, I don't know. What does that mean? I'm not quite sure. Well, I want to tell you, it is the gospel. It is the good news that I'm about to share with you. And the Bible is very clear about the condition of us as humans. And the condition is that we are sinful. Romans says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All. Everyone. That might be shocking to you that a person on stage that you're meeting for the first time ever is calling you a sinner. I am, because it's true. And I'm a sinner too. And everyone who is sitting in a seat in here is a sinner. And everyone that you have ever met before is a sinner. And everyone that you will ever meet again is a sinner. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And that is a problem because also in Romans, it says this about sin. That sin, the wages of sin is death, a physical death, but also a spiritual separation for eternity from our Creator God. That's a problem. But here's the good news. But the gift, the free gift of God is eternal life. The free gift of God is eternal life. It's a gift. And you have the opportunity right now, today, in this exact moment, to receive that gift of eternal life, of salvation, to be raised to life with Christ. Right now, there is nothing standing in your way, and I pray so much that you would make that decision to decide to make Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior. I'm a sinner. I need a Savior, to make the decision right now and be raised with Christ. I promise you, this passage will make a lot more sense if you do that, all right? If you need to talk to anyone, we have a church full of people who would love to talk to you about that decision if you made that this morning. So if then, back to the passage, which really is, since then you have been raised with Christ, that's the indicative. That is the statement of who we are. You have been raised with Christ. Since you have been raised with Christ, here's the imperative. Seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. So we've got our identity. We are raised with Christ. Here's the imperative. Seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Seek is to aspire to aim a continuous effort towards, seeking the things that are above, where Christ is. Now, what does that mean? What are the things that are above? Should I just look up and, no. It's the exact opposite of what was happening in the previous verse that Pastor Jeff went through last week. It's the opposite of the things on the earth that the legalists were teaching. They were so concerned about the things on the earth. They were so concerned about the rules of Sabbath and holy days and eating traditions and just traditions in general that we learned from Pastor Jeff last week. And Paul is urging them to stop concerning themselves with such trivial things and focus on the things that are ultimately essential and transcendent. Seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. So what does that mean? What does it mean to seek the things that are above, to seek? Well, I think it's not complicated at all. It's to seek Jesus. To seek Jesus. And I wrote down three ways that we can do that. We can seek Jesus' heart. That's the first one. Seek Jesus' heart. Knowing and understanding. What was Jesus' heart for? Who was he for? What did he care about? And we have the scriptures to guide us in that. To know what Jesus cared about, who he cared about. Having a heart like Jesus, that's seeking the things that are above. The next thing is seek Jesus' will, his purpose and his plans. His purposes and plans for the world, his purpose and plans for yours and my life. Seek Jesus' will, his purpose and plans to be done. And then finally, seek Jesus' presence. Seek Jesus' presence. Spending time with him, spending time hearing from him, from his word, taking time to speak with him in prayer, taking time to be in worship, praising him, ascribing him worth for all that he has done, seeking his presence. Seek Jesus' heart, will, and presence. Those are the things that are above. The verse goes on to say, so it says, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. See how quickly we can, like, go over that verse, seated at the right hand of God. And sometimes it's just a thing that we read and we're like, oh, that's nice. He's got a seat. That's really nice. I like to sit too. It's so much more important than, this is not a throwaway verse that sits at the end of a piece of scripture and we just say, that's nice. This is so important. There is so much in just those couple of words right there. Seated at the right hand of God. Because of what Jesus has done on the cross, because of who he is, God has exalted Jesus and given him honor and has given him authority. That's what it means to sit at the right hand of someone. That's a place of honor. It's a place of authority. And God the Father has given that to Jesus Christ because of his great sacrifice for you and for me and the great grace that he has given us. He has seated him at the right hand of God. Aren't you so glad that Jesus is not in the grave? He's not in the grave. He is seated at the right hand of God, to whom all honor is due, and who has authority over all things. That's Jesus. So let us seek the things that are above. And then it goes on to say, set your minds on the things that are above, not on the things that are on the earth. Set your minds on the things that are above, not on the things that are on the earth. To set is to select, to choose, to make a priority. Set your mind on the things above. Because you see, things start to change when I do this. Things start to change when you start to set your mind on the things above and not on the things on earth. You see, from the earth, things are pretty difficult. We don't have a very good perspective of our surroundings. We don't have a very good grip on things. And so when something comes in our life, a difficulty, a situation, when our life gets into the weeds, we can't see past it. The only thing that we're able to focus on is the thing that's right in front of us. How do I deal with this? What do I do about this? I can't see past this, God. I can't move past it. What do I do? I have no hope. Something's blocking my vision. Something's blocking my way. I don't know what to do. The scripture is telling us not to set your mind on the things that are on the earth, but instead to set them on the things that are above, where Christ is. Do you see the difference between those two positions? The perspective of the mind when set on the things above is completely different than on the earth. On the earth, it's in the weeds. It can't see the way to go. But when it's set on the things that are above, the mind's perspective changes. And these things that were so impossibly crippling in our life, well, they don't really compare anymore, do they? We have a different perspective on how we see the problems and the trials and the circumstances that we go through in our life, because we are setting our minds on the things that are above. We're setting them on the right things. And you know, one of the greatest things that prohibits this imperative that Paul is giving to us to set our minds, to seek and set my mind on the things of God, one of the biggest things that prohibit that is earthly distraction. We just talked about it a little bit. But I made some top distractions that keep us from seeking and setting our minds on Christ. The first one I already talked about in the beginning of my message, and that is health issues. Health issues. Something's going on, a sickness has happened, a diagnosis has gone on in your life or in the life of a loved one. And all of a sudden, that's the only thing that you're focusing on. That's the only thing that you're giving attention to. You are distracted from setting your mind on the things above because you're setting your mind on that. Number two is busyness. Busyness. I got to keep my schedule. No, you don't understand. I don't know if I have time for that, all right? Have you seen it? Have you seen the schedule? I've got lots to do. There's a lot of urgent things that need to take place this week. I don't know if I'm going to have time. I don't know if I'm going to have time to spend it with the Lord. I just don't know. I'll see how my week kind of progresses. We'll see. It's busyness, right? I'm running here. I'm running there. I'm distracted from setting my mind on the things that are above. Another thing is fear. Fear. Fear can be very crippling, where it's the only thing that you're thinking about is fear in my life. The fear of the things that are going on in my life. Another thing is money stress. Money stress. This is a big one. I don't know where our next meal is coming from. I don't know how we're going to make the payment on the house. I don't know how I'm going to make the payment on the car. In fact, our car just broke down. What are we going to do? We don't have money to fix that. It could be so distracting. It keeps us thinking about the things on the earth instead of setting our minds on the things that are above. What about selfishness? Me, 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 me. What a distraction that is. I want, I want, I want. How many times are we distracted by our selfishness? That is for sure not setting our minds on the things that are above. That is setting our minds right where our minds are placed right now, in myself. Myself, myself, myself. Another one is drama. Everyone loves a new drama. That's what social media has taught me. I'm not like really good at social media, but I do know like that one thing that everyone likes to talk about. You know, the newest thing, the latest thing, what's going on, politics, all of that. Another one is tragedy. Difficult situation in my life, a tragic situation in my life can keep me very distracted on the temporal and earthly things that are happening. I just wrote down two more things, past and future. My past can be very distracting. Things that I wish that I didn't do, regret and shame. And the future is unknown. What's gonna happen a week from now, a month from now? That can be very distracting. It's keeping my vision and my mind and my heart set on things of the earth. And Paul is urging us, set your mind on the things that are above, not on the things that are on earth. Because the reality is that these things are hard, and we could probably go all day writing down other things that keep us distracted from looking up and setting our minds on the things that are above. Amen? We could keep going and keep going and keep going. We could make a whole page, then we could turn it over and make it, you know, do another page of things, and then add some more paper, and we could keep going. There's so many things that are distracting us from setting our minds and our hearts on the things that are above. These are hard things. These are difficult things. None of these are easy. But here's the truth. Remember, your perspective changes when you set your mind on the things that are above. And the perspective that we're looking at this is, wow, that's, how do I get past that? But the reality is when I start setting my mind on the things that are above, my perspective shifts, it changes, and it becomes not, how am I gonna do this? It becomes, Jesus is greater than all of these things. Jesus is greater than everything that I will face in this life. Jesus is greater than the pain that I have, the circumstance I'm going through, the struggle that I have. He is greater. And when I set my mind and my heart upon the things that are above, we stop looking at things with such an earthly perspective and we see it in a heavenly perspective. God, you are greater than this, which means you are in control, which means you are going to provide, which means you are loving me through this. You are with me in this. What an amazing truth that is, amen? What an amazing truth. So the first fundamental is of the Christ-centered life is seeks Jesus first. Seeks Jesus first. The second thing that we're gonna see is embraces new identity. Embraces new identity. Look at verse 3 with me. It says, for you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Now that seems really confusing at first. What does that mean? For you have died. Well, it's not talking about a physical death. It's again this theme that is raised throughout Colossians, this theme of dying and being raised to life in Christ. That's the theme that's present here again. Saying you have died. You have died. What have we died to? Sin. We've died to sin, right? We are dead to sin. Another thing that I wrote down is we have died to self. We have died to self. The idea that I want to be my own boss. No, no, no. I'm in control of my own life. It's me. I'm the king. Boss. Me. No. The Christ-centered life. We are dead to that. We are dead to sin, we are dead to self, and we have been raised with Christ. Dead to sin, dead to self. Then it says this, it says, for you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Now this has two definitions, two different meanings, the word hidden there. The first one is secure, kept, safe. It's secure. My life is hidden with God. It is secure. The other definition is not yet fully revealed. And I don't mean that the definition is not yet fully revealed. That is the definition. Is that Hidden means not yet fully revealed. This is speaking to our identity. This is speaking to our identity as Christ followers, that we have an identity that is not yet fully revealed, but will be someday. Our identity will be fully revealed someday, and we're going to learn about that in just a little bit. So secured and not yet fully revealed. This is directly speaking to the identity we have in Christ. I just wrote down three words that I think summarize this idea of being our life being hidden. The first one is concealed. That's speaking to our life not yet fully revealed. The next word I wrote down was protected. Protected. Protected from evil. Protected from the enemy. Our life is protected in Christ, in God. And then finally, again, secure, held by Christ and God. I mean, does it get more secure than that? Held by Christ in God. Like, so if someone's coming after you, they got to go through Jesus Christ and God the Father. Well, that feels pretty safe to me. I'm pretty pumped about that. Well, what an awesome promise that is. What an awesome identity that is for us. We are secure. No one's getting to our life. No one's getting through Jesus and God. He is keeping us safe. He's kind of bringing us into our own little safe space. Now, maybe you've heard about these. They're kind of rampant on college campuses right now. Safe space. Maybe that's tainted the word for you a little bit. I'm sorry. Have you heard about these? I know that the college students here have. Has everyone else heard about the safe spaces? Okay, let me explain them to you. All right, so there are these places on college campuses called safe spaces. They are new, fairly new. And when life gets difficult, when people say mean things, there's a word that I don't fully understand, microaggressions, all of that. If those things happen to you, then you could go to this place on campus called a safe space. And in that safe space, you can pet puppies. You can paint with watercolors. You can play with Play-Doh. It's like a nursery for college students, right? The safe space where you are protected from all of the things that are going on outside. You get to go there and just have the time of your life and be a child. I don't know. I'm not sure. And so when you think of safe space, maybe that's what you were thinking of. Maybe you were like, oh, safe space. I've heard about those. Those kind of seem ridiculous. Can I just say that God's safe space for you, that God keeping your life safe, is infinitely better than petting a puppy and painting with watercolors. Infinitely better. Infinitely. Him keeping our life safe is ultimately and infinitely better than that. And that's an incredible promise and truth for us. This is our identity. We are secure in Christ the Son and God the Father. We are protected by Christ the Son and God the Father. We have an identity that is not yet fully revealed, but one day will be an everlasting. And you know, this issue of identity is pretty big in our world, isn't it? And our world has a lot to say about our identity. And a lot of people, and sadly sometimes Christians are guilty of this as well, is we find our identity from the world. What does the world say about me? That's my identity, right? What does the world say about me? That is my identity. And so the world starts saying stuff to us about who we are and what our identity is. Oh, and my identity is found in the way that I look. My identity is found in the job that I have. It's found in the money that I make. It's found in the house that I live in. What are some other things that the world tells us that we find our identity in? Our ability? Ability? What else? Hobbies? Children, yeah. What was that? Talents. That's a good one. I would also add just this one, which is of recent note to me. I don't know if you guys have heard about these. So Enneagram, anyone heard about that? A lot of people are finding their identity from that right there. Full disclosure, I had no idea what those were. Our office has kind of been buzzing about the Enneagram and the number, and I finally caved in and like took a test. I still don't know what it means. All right, they're like, what are you? I'm like, I'm a nine. And they're like, what's your wing? I'm like, what? What do you mean, what's my wing? I have no idea. They're like, well, you're a 9 wing 8. I'm like, that sounds like a made up thing you just said to me. And they're like, you're a peacemaker. I'm like, well, that's good, right? That's good. They're like, whoa, sometimes it's good, but you just wait until you're under stress. Whoa. Like, I don't know. A lot of people are finding their identity in the Enneagram. They're finding their identity in a number. And they're saying, this is who I am. This is who I am. This is exactly who I am. And I can't change because this is who I am. This is the way that the world gives us identity. And what Jesus is doing is saying that no, this is not your identity. This is not your identity. Your identity isn't found in these things. Your identity isn't found in your looks or your job or money or your ability or your talent or your house or an Enneagram. It is not found in any of that. Your identity is found in me. Your identity is in me. It is hidden with me. Because of the shed blood on the cross, Jesus Christ purchased us. And now our identity is nothing other than in Christ. And it is, our life is hidden in him. And we are not going by the identity of the world any longer. We are going by the identity of Jesus Christ. That's our identity. That's your identity. And the Bible says so much about that, that you are a child of God, that you are beloved, that you are forgiven. Your identity is not those things. Your identity is in Jesus Christ, secure, hidden, and so great that it can't even be fully revealed yet. Are you embracing it? Are you? Are you embracing that identity, the new identity that Jesus has given to us? There's one more thing that we're going to see in Colossians 3. Seeks Jesus first, embraces new identity, and then finally this, anticipates future glory. Anticipates future glory. Look at verse 4. When Christ, who is your life, there's another identity, Christ who is your life appears, that's the second coming, then you also will appear with him in glory. Whoa! Is that really going to happen? I know, you're thinking that right now. Yes, we know by, it says when. Does not say if, possibly, maybe, perhaps, perchance. It says when. It is definitive. It is assured. It is a promise. When Jesus comes back, when Jesus, who is our life, appears, then another promise, another assurance. When this happens, then this happens. You will also appear with him in glory. Yes. I love that. You will appear with him in glory. How awesome is that? Amen. The identity that is hidden in Christ, the one that has yet to be fully revealed, will be finally revealed in this moment of glory when Jesus Christ comes back. And we are to anticipate this future glory. Anticipate the future glory. Because the reality is also is that it's not truly our glory. Yes, it's a glorious thing and believers have glory, but the glory is ultimately coming from Christ. It's ultimately coming from Christ and his grace, which we share with him. We are but a mere reflection of the glory of Jesus Christ. I mean, think about the sun and the moon, right? The moon is beautiful. The moon is glorious in its own right and has glory of its own, does it not? It's a beautiful thing. But the moon gets its glory because the sun is reflecting on the moon. The moon is merely a reflection of the glory of the sun. We are the moon, and Jesus Christ is the sun. And we are only reflections of his incredible glory. That's what we get to be. Aren't you excited for that day? When you get to stand with Jesus in everlasting and in glory? I can't wait. I'm so excited for that. But you see, one of the problems with focusing on earthly things instead of setting our hearts and minds on the things that are above is that there can be no anticipation. When I set my mind on the things that are on earth, I'm not thinking about anything else. I'm thinking about that situation right there. My life is surrounded around that. There's no anticipation of future. There's no anticipation of the hope of the future. I'm trying to deal with the now, and that's it. There's so much more. When I set my mind on the things that are above, my perspective changes, and I anticipate the future glory. I yearn for it. I long for it. It kind of makes me think of Christmas, like a little bit, when we were kids, that anticipation that we had the night before, the morning of, before we opened a present. Do you guys remember that? Listen, B5 for just a second, okay? Go back, B5, remember that. Remember that anticipation you guys got? You know, we had a tradition in our house. When we were younger, my mom was sitting right here at the 9 o'clock service. And when we were younger, we had to wait at the bottom of the stairs. And we had to sing Christmas songs until my parents woke up and told us that we could come upstairs. And so, you know, we would sing. And we could only come upstairs. We could only come upstairs when they said, okay, you guys can come up now. And so naturally, we would wake up at roughly, I don't know, like 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning, and we would start singing. And we would sing and sing and sing, and we would go through every single Christmas carol that we knew. And then when we finished and they still didn't call us up, we'd start right back over and we'd sing it a little bit louder. And we'd sing it a little bit more yelly than we would actually singing and to wake our parents up. And, you know, usually it would take about 30 minutes, maybe 45 minutes. But I remember one time just so vividly where we were sitting there and singing for what felt like 2 hours. And I was like, the anticipation that was in my heart. I mean, I was starting to put that into the lyrics. I was like, deck the halls with, get up! Balls of holly. And I wanted to go upstairs and open the presents. The anticipation was killing me. I was yearning and longing for what did I get this year? What present did I get this year? And as soon as my mom and dad came over, leaned over the side of the stairs and said, all right, probably out of frustration, you guys can come up now. We sprinted up the stairs and immediately just started diving into the presents. What is it? Let's have an anticipation like that for the future glory of Jesus Christ, for the future of our faith. Let's have an anticipation like that, a childlike anticipation, waiting, yearning, longing for the future of our faith. That's the hope of our faith is coming, has come, is coming again in Jesus Christ. And we will be with him in glory everlasting. Amen. How amazing is that? These are the fundamentals of a Christ-centered life. These are the fundamentals. A person who seeks Christ first, who embraces new identity, and who anticipates future glory. We need to get back to that right there. In the most difficult times, in the most difficult seasons, in the hardest moments, we need to rely on the fundamentals. Can I just tell you, when we realized what was happening to us in Zion's diagnosis, these are the things that we went back to. We had to take our eyes off of the things that were on the earth and set our minds and our hearts on the things that are above where Christ is. We'd embrace our identity. We had to know that Jesus was greater than all of the things that we faced. We had to talk to him and hear from him. And we had to anticipate the future. God, this is your plan. You have a plan for this. The future is unknown to me, but it is not to you. You are in control. And God, we trust you. So maybe you're going through a similar situation right now, a tough season, a difficult circumstance. Get back to the basics, the fundamentals of faith. Seek Jesus, embrace your identity in Christ, and anticipate the future glory that awaits us in everlasting. Let me pray for us. God, we thank you for your word this morning. It's so good. And Lord, you knew that we would be here this week. You knew exactly what our hearts needed. To stop looking at the earthly things. To stop focusing on those. And to seek and to set our minds on the things that are above. Seek and set our minds on you. Lord, these aren't easy things. The distractions are, well, they're distracting and they're difficult. But you are greater than everything that we face. In every season of life, you are faithful. Lord, remind us this week as we do life together to continue to seek after you, to continue to embrace the identity that you have given us, not the world. And Lord, help us to anticipate the future glory that we have with you and in you. Help us with these things this week, Lord, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.